About 6 months to 1 year ago, there was a lot of content published about the Arrow library. And I was curious and I investigated what is Arrow and what it does. But the Arrow website is not really for beginners. So you have to learn from the beginning. So I decided to investigate how Arrow relates with the functional programming. This made me understand more about functional programming too. So this is this talk is just about sharing my findings. I am not really expert on Arrow, and we haven't been using Arrow in production. So I'm just a beginner level. I've tried it in some pet projects, but I want to share what I've learned. So let's start with functional programming. This is the definition of functional programming, but I will go step by step and explain the key points in this definition. It's a programming paradigm. Programming paradigm is classification of programming languages based on their features. The most famous example to that is object-oriented programming. Kotlin is object-oriented programming language, but it doesn't stop Kotlin to have functional programming features. So a language could be both, it can support both of the paradigms. Functional programming treats computation as evolution of mathematical functions. Let's look at what mathematical functions are. In a mathematical function, we have two sets, and function is the relation between elements of the first set and elements of the second set. But from first set, there could be only one relation to the second set's elements. Let's visualize it. It could be more clear. We have first set. The elements are 1, 2, 3, 4, and the second set is A, B, C. Let's define the relations with arrows. You can think the first set as input and the second set as output. If you notice, 1 and 2 is related with A. This is perfectly valid function, but 2 cannot relate to A and B. So what functional programming is in the basics is sorry, I couldn't hear. Is there any questions? I will continue then.
Sorry to interrupt, Hadi, but we can't actually hear you at the moment. Your microphone's deactivated, I think.
Oh, sorry.
Sorted.
Continue. So basically what functional programming suggests is for the same input, a function should return the same output. To achieve this, functional programming avoids state and mutable data. Let's talk about state. State is the current condition of a program, which is usually represented with global variables or static variables. In our example, we have a global variable, which is list. In the function, we are filtering the list and reassigning it to itself, the filtered list. So if you are using this list in your function somewhere, your output will be changed depending on the elements of this list. Instead, what we need to do is we need to create a new list containing the elements of the first list that is filtered and added to the list. And in mutable data, let's say we have function that receives an argument as list. It has an iterator and it removes the elements from the list if they are divisible by two. So if any other function is using this list, their behavior will be changed as well. So what we need to do is again create a new list instead of modifying the first list. If we are changing state and data, there are some questions we need to ask for our program to work correctly. First one is, who is the owner of data? If our variable is a global class variable, then you can think the object owning that data is the owner. But in Kotlin, you can have top-level variables. Also in Java, you have static variables. They don't have any owners. Secondly, what would happen when data changes? As we just saw, if other places using this data, do I want their behaviors to be changed? Thirdly, should I notify other parts of the program for this change, or they need to fetch it every time they need to run? If I want to notify, how I should notify them? Am I gonna use a reactive approach, for example? And what happens when there are multiple changes at the same time? Now we can have concurrency issues that we need to sort. With functional programming, we don't need to ask these questions. We try to achieve fully functional programs by using pure functions. Pure functions always return the same result when the arguments are same, and it has no side effects. Let's see what's the side effect. We just saw that changing a static variable or changing the value of the argument is a side effect. Throwing an exception could be a side effect because in Kotlin we don't include exceptions on the function signature. We are just saying that we will return some type. But when we throw an exception, we are breaking this contract. IO operations also consider side effect. When we have a void or unit function that doesn't return anything but writing something, doing an IO operation, this is considered as side effect. What functional programming tries to do, or even error tries to do, is trying to at least represent what is the IO operation. Let's see how Kotlin is a functional program. How Kotlin can provide functional programming language features. The first feature is package level functions. In this example, all I need is a function that will log our messages. We don't need to do anything with this class. So with package level functions, we can get rid of the class and import this package whenever we need to use it, and just use it like another function. Secondly, higher order functions. In Java, or if we don't have higher order functions, when we need a callback after a long running operation, we would have to have an interface and the abstract method to be able to let the caller know the results of the long running operation. In this example, we have a callback and it has onComplete method. When we want to call it, we need to create an instance of this interface and pass it to the function that we are calling. But in Kotlin, we don't actually need to wrap our function in a class. They can live by itself. Also, functions can take functions as parameters. Also, they can return functions. These types of functions are called higher order functions. In this example, our operation with a callback function takes an argument called callback, which takes no arguments and returns unit, which is not returning anything. We can just call this function just like a regular function with parentheses. To call this, we can create a lambda in the parentheses. When the function argument is the last argument, we can move parentheses out, curly brackets out of the parentheses. And if it is the only parameter the function is receiving, we can get rid of the parentheses altogether. And we will end up something like this. The second area higher order functions are used is changing or specifying a behavior of a function. Let's say we have a customer object like this, a customer class like this, and it has name and city properties. If we want to filter it and print it, we would need two functions to do this job. These two functions looks identical. Only different thing is the condition that we are doing the filter. With Kotlin, we can pass it as a parameter. It's called predicate. It defines what is the condition that a filter would run. We pass this predicate to filter, and we can print the filtered list. In the first call here, we are filtering customers by city. And in the second one, we are filtering it by name. Another useful Kotlin feature is extension function. With extension function, we can add functions to existing classes. Let's see why we need it. Let's say we have a function that we want it to return the third character of a string. If we don't have extension functions, we can write an object in Kotlin or have a static method in Java to do this operation. But with extension, this is how we're gonna call this object to get the third letter. With extension functions, we can add this function to strings list of functions. If you notice, this function doesn't take any arguments. We are writing the code just as we are writing a function in the string class. If we want to call this function, we can just create a string object and call it just like any other function. What this achieves is, if I want to use this function in the first example, I would have to know about the string utils class or object. Because there is no way I can discover this function. But with extension functions, when I type Kotlin and press dot, IDE will show me this function in the functions list. So I can discover this and use it just like any other class function. Extension functions are also used in code-based designs. This is Kotlin collections for each method. This is a extension function. They could have add this as a class function to iterable, but instead what they have done is put that in an extension function. The idea behind it is put the core functionality in the class itself and move optional things as extension function. This will reduce the size of the class, firstly. And if I want to use some extension function, all I need to do is import it and use it. And let's talk about Airroof. We've talked about functional programming tries to achieve the same input should output, should have the same output in the functions. And to do that, it tries to avoid state and mutual data. Airroof helps us in these three areas. The first one is having functions return what they've suggested. Secondly, they have it has some types to achieve mutability. So you, if you have an object and you want to change something with that object and create something new, Airroof has constructs to achieve that. If we look at the website on what arrow is actually is, it says that arrows aims to provide a lingua franca of interfaces and abstractions across Kotlin libraries. Lingua franca means commonly used language. So Arrow is not the inventor of functional programming. There were many functional programming languages and platforms. So their common language is these keywords. If you don't know what they mean, you don't need to worry about it for now. I will not go into many of this. But once you start with Arrow and you start using, you can learn these one by one. Let's talk about try. I just mentioned that throwing an exception could be a side effect. In order to avoid this, Arrow has this construct to encapsulate the exception, also the value. So try could contain two things. It could either have an exception or the actual value. When we call this function, and it's gonna return a try. In this case, we can write get or else to do whatever we want to do if there is no exception thrown. We can also do get or default to specify the default value when there's an exception. And finally, we can use fault to process the exception state and the regular value state. Try is just deprecated in favor of either. Either has a similar idea. In try, you can have an exception and a value. In either, you can either have one of the two values. It can contain something like this. You can have different types of values in the either. This is a common use case on Android development. Sometimes you receive a string resource ID. Sometimes you have to use the string coming from an API. So you can put this in an either. So either is a sealed class. You can create left or right types of the either using these functions. So if we are using a resource, it's returning a resource ID. Otherwise, it's returning the string itself. When we want to use it, since it's a sealed class, we can check the type. If it is left, we can just have the string value. If it is right, we can get the string with the resource ID. Options is also similar, but the difference is option could have an empty. It could have an actual value, or it could have an empty represents there is nothing that we can possibly have. In this example, we are having a divide operation. It takes two arguments, X and Y, and it divides X by Y. If Y is zero, there is nothing we can do about it. We can either throw an exception or we can return an option like this here. If it is okay, we can we can do the operation and create an option with just function with that value. We can do map with option types. If the option empty is returned, it will not do anything. But if it is, if option contains an actual value, it will do this operation and return it as a option too. So the results type will be option in both of the cases. As conclusion, I think functional programming is really cool idea. We should try to have these principles in our applications as much as we can to reduce the problems and make our applications more predictable. But the Arrow library and functional programming in general has its own knowledge, so there's the entry barrier to it. It's just like RxJava, I think. So it's up to you if you want to use it or not. But again, we should try to benefit from the idea behind the functional programming as much as we can. Thank you very much for listening to me. I will be around for questions. There are two questions we have so far. If you have any other questions, please add them as well. So when would you choose object-oriented programming instead of functional programming? I think we shouldn't be bound by the programming paradigm. Kotlin supports both of these paradigms, and we should benefit from them as much as we can. So when you need to extend an object, you should do that. Or if you can get away with an extension function, you should do that also. You should decide whatever is good for you, since both of the approaches are supported. The second question is, are there any negative sides? I actually mentioned about those at the end of the presentation. So it could, I think it creates an entry barrier to new starters. The types that I've shown is just barely the surface of it. There are a lot of types and operations with the functional programming. They are really complicated. Some of them I couldn't understand because I didn't have the real need for it. So yeah, that's the biggest negative side with functional programming and using Arrow. If you are of course trying to do pure functional programming, again there is nothing wrong to use as much as you can in your project. Is this kind of functional programming 100% debuggable without any issue in the IDE? Yes, that is one of the benefits from the functional programming. Since functional programming treats the program as the flow of data instead of having states, you would always have same outputs with the same inputs, which is really cool. So that's why I think we should try to stick as much as we can. I guess that is it. Could we hang in here for some chats? What's the procedure now? Lucy.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Hadi, for your presentation today. As some of you might have seen from the note in the messages part of the platform, we're taking questions on Slido. So take a look at the messages part and you'll see the link where you can submit questions for Hadi around this topic. I'd just like to thank once again Synesthesia and AWS Amplify, our sponsor for today's webinar. Thank you, Hadi, and back over to you for questions now.
Thank you very much. I've already taken the questions that are in the Slido. So if there are other questions, I can answer.